Jeff, it is a real honor and pleasure to be back here at Jackson State University. It's always cool to kind of come in on one of the NEA seminars kind of in this third week, because y'all all kind of know each other and know who you like and don't like. I know you're around and who talks, who does talk, what this person's gonna say, that person's gonna say. It's always kind of cool, the vibe has already been set. Today, I kind of want to talk a little bit about Lowndes County, Alabama, and a little bit about SNCC, a little bit about Black Power, and how it connects to the Mississippi Movement. And also how sort of Mississippi and Lowndes County, the movement that happened there, what SNCC does there, how it really impacts this national narrative of what the civil rights movement is, or what we sort of have come to be here at the moment. So first, I want to talk a little bit about what I call these disruptions. What does this Lowndes story disrupt when it comes to sort of the normative narrative of the civil rights movement? And first, really quickly, sort of what is this Lowndes story? In one and a half sentences, Lowndes County, Alabama is located in the heart of the Alabama Black Belt, sandwiched between Selma, Alabama, the capital of the Economic Confederacy in Alabama, and Montgomery, the capital of the state. Black Belt County, 80% African American historically. At the start of 1965, Lowndes County, Alabama, 80% African American, had 5,122 African Americans were eligible to vote, voter registration age, zero registered to vote. In other words, political exclusion was absolute. Nobody was on the votes, not even one or two good Negroes, right? Like, nobody was on the votes. That's the start of 1965. By the end of 1966, because of this partnership between local people and SNCC organizers, not only had a majority of African Americans succeeded in registering to vote in Lowndes County, Alabama, but they had created their own independent political party that didn't just mimic sort of traditional American politics, and I'll say something more about that, but really created a different kind of democratic small D politics. And so what I try to do in my book, Bloody Lowndes, is really talk not only about sort of what happened, but how it happened. But this story of transformation from zero registered voters, political exclusion being absolute, to not only succeeding in getting people engaged in the political process, but creating their own independent political party, really disrupts a number of things that are connected to what we consider, which you all have been discussing and talking about here, this normative civil rights movement, this narrative. And the first one is chronology. Right? Because what happens in Lowndes County begins at a time when many say the movement is supposed to have ended in many fundamental ways, right? I mean, things don't really begin to jump off, if you will, until 1965. And certainly, they don't pick up steam. We're talking about after the Voting Rights Act, after the Civil Rights Act. So they're not even picking up steam until 1966, moving into the Black Power era. So in many ways, what happens in Lowndes County, one of the reasons why it's often not talked about in this normative narrative of the civil rights movement is that it fits outside of this chronology, right? Outside of the time when you get not only the 64 Civil Rights Act, but the 1965 Voting Rights Act, most folks are like, look, you know, liberal allies of black folk. I got the Voting Rights Act, what else can you go eat? Right? Kind of move on. Just wait for the king to die 3 years later, right? So it really challenges that on the back end, 1965, pushing into the 60s. Saying, wait a minute, this sense of organizing is still going on, this grassroots organizing is still going on, it doesn't suddenly end with federal legislation. But then, we might be able to get to this, it really pushes the chronology back earlier, right? So the book ends, right? So in other words, things don't suddenly begin. And in fact, there are real silences in places like Lowndes County, Alabama, and most places throughout the heart of the Black Belt, real silences around what people are doing, right? So, In rural places, like rural Lowndes County, Alabama, many rural places here in Mississippi, you don't have people walking on, marching on county courthouses after
World War II attempted to register to vote. There's no bus boycotts in 1955, although Lyons County is right next door to Selma, right next door to Montgomery, Alabama. You have to go back to the 1930s to find any significant kind of mass action, mass public protest. In a place like Lyons County, Alabama, 1935, there's a sharecropper strike that is brutally suppressed, right, with a dozen or so people who wind up dead, that leads to this silence around public activism. But that in and of itself is very telling. It tells why there is silence around public protest after this period leading up to 1965. But it also says, wait a minute, what's going on here that you even have this kind of protest public protest in 1935? So it really challenges this chronology in a number of different ways. Was that, did you have a hand or something? Oh, okay. By the way, if any questions pop up, while we're, I'm not going to talk, I could talk to you about it, but I don't plan to talk to you about it. So by all means, chair, interrupt, engage. So challenge, disrupting this movement chronology. It's another disruption. Movement goals and tactics. So one of the things that I'm big on, I'm not a big fan of the term civil rights, right? I think it's what we use, but it doesn't fully and adequately describe, in my humble estimation, what it was that black folk were trying to achieve. Because on the one hand, certainly they were trying to achieve basic civil rights, but they were also very much trying to achieve human rights. Nothing in the U.S. Constitution about housing, decent housing. Nothing in the U.S. Constitution about education or access to education. But education becomes fundamental to one of the goals of sort of African-American activism, the African-American freedom struggle. And these are not goals that just emerged out of nowhere in the 1950s and 1960s. Certainly by now, it should be clear to everyone that the goals that African-Americans were fighting for that they had identified have deep roots. Literally, the moment of emancipation, people are struggling for the same things that they would be struggling for and fighting for, consciously identified a century later. And that didn't suddenly come out of nowhere at the moment of emancipation. Right? I mean, these are things that black folk have been thinking about even while they were enslaved. Nobody understood what freedom was better than the person who was enslaved and denied their basic freedom their entire time. So what I see is what black folk are fighting for, I call them freedom rights. Right? It's a combination of civil rights and human rights. It's how black folk define freedom. Even in slavery, certainly in emancipation, and for the century and a half afterward. You want to say?
Access to health, addressing health disparities,
Absolutely. But we see the connections. Today we talk about food deserts. But if you go back to the turn of the century, one of the things, turn of the 19th century, so turn of the 20th century, we're talking about food deserts and access to literally access to healthy foods, right? You go back to the turn of the 20th century, late 19th century, you have African Americans forming cooperatives, right? Trying literally to get, and certainly in the early 1900s, 19-teens, 1920s, you talk about farm agents, home demonstration agents, trying to get African Americans not only to diversify crops, but also eat healthy. Right? But there's this real continuity in the things that African Americans have been engaged in struggling for. And certainly access to healthcare, right? Literally trying to gain access to doctors. Right? I mean, these are things that literally you can connect decade after decade after decade. So black folk are fighting for the CDs forever, right down the road, right up the road. So what people are fighting for in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s have these deep roots. They look different, but they certainly are connected. They all belong on a continuum. So when we think about sort of movement goals and objectives, what people are fighting for in the 1960s, now, I'll explain to you why this becomes really important for organizers. It really has these deep roots that stretch back. They belong on a continuum. They belong on a continuum. Right? And the same thing with tactics, right? And certainly, I think the clearest definition, the clearest thing that we can look at when we're talking about tactics and how a story movement in Lyons County, as so many others, really disrupts this, it revolves around nonviolence and armed resistance. One of the things that really happens, at least that I see happening in the sort of classical civil rights era, right, 40s, 50s, 60s, really 1950s, 1960s, One of the things that's really different about this period that distinguishes it from what came before is this heavy public emphasis around nonviolence. Right? Like nonviolence philosophically, not just strategically, but nonviolence philosophically and nonviolence as a way of life. It doesn't dominate, per se, right? But it rises to a level that is really different than what came before. And this is important because, in a sense, and it's done for very strategic reasons, right? You're coming in and by certain people, right? So civil rights moderates, the NAACP, eventually with King, SCLC, the various religious leaning, liberal leaning organizations, there's a safety in talking about nonviolence, just as there's a safety during the Cold War era, McCarthy era, red baiting era, in talking about civil rights as opposed to freedom. There literally is a moment, and you can track, you can do a Google word search, one of those Google cloud bubble things where you do the word things, right? And you can track how many times civil rights is being used in the press, in the New York Times, pick a major newspaper, 1950, 51, 52, 53, 54, and it's this sort of very small. You hit about 56, 57, 58, 59, suddenly this thing is huge. And literally there's a moment in time where the term civil rights supplants what black folk, the language black folk had been using up until that point to describe what they were trying to achieve, which was freedom. Now that changes the playing field in terms of how you go about trying to secure and achieve it. Right? And it becomes much more palatable to white folk. Not talking about white Southerners in this instance, I'm talking about white folk who may be an ally somewhere down the road, because no matter what you said to white folk who were opposed to you, it was too radical and too dangerous, it didn't matter, right? But certainly talking about armed resistance was going to be something different, right? And it's armed resistance as a strategy and tactic that was the default for black folk. And black folk embraced armed resistance, like that's what they did. Like nonviolence is what was new. Like not strategically, tactically. Black folk understood, look, we're our man, we're our gun, we understand that we should do this. We got Jim Crow boycotts in Louisiana, Virginia, turn of the century. So there's always been a tactical arrow in the quiver of black folk. But that never supplanted the idea that we have a right to defend ourselves and we'll do it when necessary. But that changes in that sort of 50s, 60s with the emphasis on sort of civil rights moderates really pushing this nonviolence sort of language and rhetoric. So one of the things that happens in Lowndes County, Alabama is they're rejecting this idea that we need to be talking nonviolently. We need to be projecting a nonviolent persona. Like, we have no need for that. We're not trying to sway the minds of any white folk down here. Right? And so you see that in their rhetoric, in their action, they are saying constantly, if you come at us, we're going to come back at you. And that is our right. Which is also important because one of the things Lowndes County story is valuable for, once we move past 1965 and 1966, it helps us make sense of the transition from civil rights to black power. And one of the things that we see in this transition from sort of the civil rights era, civil rights rhetoric, to black power era, black power rhetoric, is that black power doesn't become something new. It really, in many ways, becomes a return to something that had been old. If we see the sort of civil rights movement as a civil rights era rhetoric as a disruption in and of itself. And I'll say more about that and use the independent political parties as an example. We just after lunch, y'all still with me?
Yeah. Yes.
Good?
Yes.
All right. I'm just making sure. Another disruption is the SNCC story. Because there's a narrative about SNCC that sort of leads it up until sort of 1964, MFDP, Atlantic City. And then you have the disappointment at Atlantic City. I'm purposefully framing that as disappointment at Atlantic City, where SNCC organizers then sort of lose their way. Right, they kind of get upset, they're mad, they're frustrated, they start floating around, and we kind of don't really hear about them for another 2 years until they
Stokely Carmichael and others popped back up in the Meredith March calling for black power because they're angry. Right? And so how do you go from sort of 64 to 66 without it being reduced to emotionalism? Is what Lowndes County helps us make sense of. Because you just don't go from, it's funny, up until 1964, SNCC was all about organizing and committed to organizing, and organizing is what defined what they did. And then it just sort of disappears for 2 years, and then they're all about rhetoric. Right? It's how that sort of narrative goes. But that's not the way the story actually plays out. Why would they suddenly stop doing what they had been doing just because they fell in love with two words? That doesn't make any sense, right? But that's part of that rhetoric that what happens in Lowndes County truly disrupts, and we'll talk more about that.
Could you sort of speak to the disappointment in Atlantic City and who were the people who were
Oh, you never know what happens with the weather. It was rough in some places, but we didn't get hit too bad. So I hope you enjoyed Dr. Luckett's presentation and a visit to Air Hall.
Yeah.
Good. I figured you'd be a good stand-in. We have a few announcements, a few housekeeping details. We have week two evaluations. They're coming around now. Also, this morning we have scheduled small group discussions. However, Michelle and I were just talking. Since we did not do the Delta trip, would you all like to just have a general pool group discussion instead of breaking out into small groups? Yeah. Oh, we'd rather break out into a small group. What's up? Either way.
people want to go, that's where the people can go. We support you. But we don't believe in that. And so therefore, the next step for them was to pull out. Individually. So a person like Stokely Carmichael, who cuts his teeth, learns how to organize in Mississippi, says, you know what? I gotta find someplace else. Because I don't believe that we this particular political approach will work for black folk. We gotta go full core, hardcore independent. And that's part of that response. So the response isn't paralyzing frustration and anger, or paralyzing frustration that will eventually lead them to succumb to the intoxication of the call for black power 2 years later, right? It's frustration. They're frustrated because the Democratic Party should have done something more.
When you get disillusioned, that's when you say, I'm good.
Right, like this is not good, this is not, I can't fool with y'all, right? But that doesn't lead to this paralysis, and that's the point. Right? They keep doing what they're doing, right? I.e. organized. They're just trying to figure out how to do it in a different way.
So, yeah. Who was frustrated? I mean, sort of give us your take on who were the frustrated people that were part of MFP, part of SNCC. Who were those people?
Well, I think there's a degree, there's enough frustration to go around, right? So there's degrees of frustration. Like, nobody's coming out of Mississippi, coming out of Atlantic City like, oh, boy, we did good, right? It's unfortunate, but this is such a wonderful thing. I think there's degrees of frustration of not being able to go forward, not being able to get the Democratic Party to actually move. So the intractable nature of sort of racist liberalism, if the two can actually get turned, right? So there's certainly, everybody has a degree of frustration, but for a number of SNCC activists, and certainly those who will then pick up roots in Mississippi and move to Alabama, right? So that includes sort of Stokely Carmichael, eventually Janet Jermont. Those folk who had organized in Mississippi, coming out of the Atlantic City experience, two things will happen. One, we gotta go full independent. And that's partly a reflection of the frustration of what we see as the possibilities within the Democratic Party. That's one thing. And the other that becomes really important, especially for these SNCC activists, I'm talking strictly about SNCC activists now, these handful of SNCC activists will leave and relocate to Alabama, is they're going to a place that also doesn't have any white activists. And that also becomes very important. So, Jan Jermont talks about this, right? She's like, why did you wind up going to Downs County, Alabama when you pick up Gloria Larry and Gloria House? People who had done some work in Mississippi or at a certain point of choosing between Mississippi and Alabama where they want to go. They said, one, you knew what Carmichael and others were talking about, independent politics, certainly about the fall of 65. But also, they were talking about doing this without having white activists there. Not because they didn't like white people. In part because they understood the dangers and the risks that were involved with having white folk there. And so they're like, okay, we can do some more of the what we would label as nationalistic things, but they were saying in very practical ways, especially coming on the heels of a freedom summit.
You know, I think the interesting thing for all of us to think about. Because the general narrative that you get in most of the books that have been written on Freedom Summer, SNCC, MFPP, in the aftermath of Atlantic City, you know, the party line is that let's think about SNCC staff people versus the local people. Think about the SNCC decision makers, and then think about the local people. Let me take you back to last Thursday. We had three of us, four of us were delegates, and one alternate that were members of the MFDP. Ed Keene was the national commitment. Victoria Jackson Gray Adams was the national committee woman. Erin Henry was the leader of the delegation, chair of the delegation. Fannie Lamer was vice chair. Lawrence Giyot was chair. And I was the vice chair of the party. Now, think about what you've read so far and heard relative to how the SNCC staff people reacted to the compromise and really what happened once they got back to Mississippi. And now, you heard Reverend Whitman, you heard Dr. Scott, you heard Mrs. Sanders, and you heard Ed Keene, and you heard Dean Partington. In retrospect, clearly the compromise was not anything that anybody in the delegation basically wanted to accept. But the reaction relative to what happened with the party, you get really a different reaction. Now, at least, you know, the party line was that the Freedom Democratic Party came back to Mississippi and worked toward getting Lyndon Johnson elected president. I mean, that was it. Now, there were other things going on, but you cannot, cannot deny that that was an element. I mean, that was going on. And then, what did Clifton Whitley say he did in 1966? Clifton Whitley ran for the U.S. Senate not once, but twice. So, now Clifton Whitley is this person from Holly Springs, Mississippi, and Aberdeen, Mississippi. So, what I want you to do is to think about the reaction of the people who were the staffers and the people who were not Mississippians, quite frankly. What happened with them? Carmichael went off to Alabama. Bob Moses went off to New York, eventually to Canada and to Africa. What did Fannie Lou Hamer do? What did Victoria Gray Adams do? What did Ed Keene do? What did Lawrence Giyot do? So I just think, let us think in those terms too. Because if you paint it with a broad brush, you would think everybody got pissed off, left the state and lived happily after in some damn other place. But that did not happen. So I just want you to think about that narrative. I want you to think closer when we talk about the impact, the role of local people in defining sort of what happened. So I'm suggesting that clearly that was great frustration, disappointment, all of the things adjectives you want to describe. But on the other hand, Cliff Whitley, Doc Drummond, Emma Sanders, these people came back and actually ran for public office in a place called Mississippi. And 83, 84-year-old Cliff Whitley, in fact, is still here. Yeah, Blackwell, I'm just, you know, and if I and all of the names crop up, but I'm just simply saying that I think that's a narrative worth thinking about, at least from the standpoint of looking at how the literature paints it now.
I think along the line, one of the things that we do tend to do too much, and I'm doing here for a very specific reason, is that we will tend to follow where so the national activists will go. Right? So usually that means following the king, right? Wherever king goes, that's where the movement is, and wherever he left, that's where the movement was, right? It no longer exists, right? And so in this sense, in order to see the link between Mississippi and Alabama, it does involve or require following where these SNCC activists would go. But that certainly doesn't mean that what happens in Mississippi suddenly stops. So that is an excellent point. So that we have in at the forefront of our mind, one, this is still going on. I mean, it's a funny thing, imagine black folks can do two things in different places at the same time. So you have this still going on when certain activists will pick up and leave, and you'll see the same thing will happen in Alabama, right? SNCC and Alice SNCC activists, Stokely Carmichael and others will be in Miles County for about 2 years. And then circumstance, political opportunity changes, they will pick up and they will move on. Doesn't mean things stop in Miles County, Alabama, or in Selma, or these other places, right? So it's absolutely important that we keep in mind, especially when we're tracking sort of national activists, that they come in to places where activism is already on, political thought and activity was already going on. And when they leave, that will continue to go on. I think that's a note worth making. So where do they land? Those big activists who will withdraw, if you will, from Mississippi. Doesn't end Mississippi, what was going on locally with the MFPP, et cetera, right? Still engaged activism there. But they will find for themselves a clean slate in Selma, Alabama. And by clean slate, I'm not talking about just as in Mississippi, you know, when Bob Moses shows up, things don't just begin when he arrived, right? This idea of a movement of fire. Obviously, you have things going on for generations. Same thing happening in Selma, Alabama. When SNCC activists arrive, when the King arrives in January of 1965, you already have, Dallas County Voters League and others engaged in, certainly in Selma, engaged in voting rights activity, engaged in a freedom rights struggle. But what for Carmichael and others, when they arrive, what they're identifying as sort of a clean slate is although it's SCLC that is kind of initiating what happens in Selma, right? They're like, okay, we can come in here and we can begin to see about creating a different, a voter rights struggle that has a somewhat different focus and emphasis, right? See if we can begin by thinking about organizing outside of even the national apparatus of the Democratic Party. It's in the back of their minds. But when they go in, it becomes a very traditional sort of voting rights campaign, right? Very traditional in terms of getting people down to the Dallas County Courthouse to register to vote. And the cooperation that we're seeing is on one hand, it's SCLC, and on the other hand, it's SNCC, SCLC, containing the organizers that were on the ground in Selma at the time, had SNCC ties and SNCC roots, right? Diane Nash, one of the lead organizers for SCLC in Selma in January of 1965. So when SNCC activists come in and participate, and you already have Bernard Lafayette, who had really laid the groundwork as a beachhead for SNCC 2 years earlier, right? You have a lot of cooperation, right? Which isn't surprising. We saw the same thing in Mississippi, hard to distinguish between some of the things that poor organizers were doing and SNCC organizers were doing in all these other places from the perspective of local people. You down to help, right? Doesn't matter your party affiliation. But very soon there is real conflict in approach between sort of those more closely associated with SNCC and those more closely associated with SCLC. And it has a lot to do with sort of what the directions that King, Martin Luther King, was sort of giving his lieutenants. And had, with regard to getting people on the voter registration books. Right? At one point, a compromise idea is floated, right? That the Justice Department, those within the Justice Department said, listen, in lieu of actually registering black folk in Dallas County, Alabama, we'll get them to sign an appearance book. And then later on down the road, we can take that sort of appearance book and get them officially registered. And some within SCLC, they were like, okay, that's a good first step. For others within SNCC, they were like, ah,
from that? What, bitch? No, no. Like, who? When's the last time you asked white folk to take their first step, right, to register to vote and sign their parents' book? Like, what is that? No, you either register them or you don't, right? You move forward. And so even in there, right, you see, so you're really beginning to see some of these some divisions being sown between sort of SNCC's approach and SCLC's approach. Right? You see this, you have the same thing, around sort of leadership and tactics, right? I mean, this becomes sort of a tactical approach to the idea of sort of King as a leader, as someone who's gonna come in and see how we can really mobilize sort of this movement in Selma for a couple months and garner some national attention, perhaps even national legislation. Versus SNCC, who's thinking much more long term in terms of what they might be able to do on the ground in terms of developing local leaders. Yes?
A time frame question. Mm-hmm. When is the conflict period in terms of when Bernard Lafayette gets there?
So Bernard Lafayette arrives in 1963, in June of 63, but by the fall he leaves. He has to go back to school, him and his wife, right? But they had connected with a number of young people who were on the ground. 1964, you see, or by the time the 1964 Civil Rights Act was passed in July of 64, you have young students, right? Because they really connected to sort of the high schoolers. They have a Freedom Day and get their heads busted up by Jim Clark and the like, right? But when SNCC organizers come back in, and it's not Lafayette then, but Carmichael and others, when they come back in, they connect with those young people who have been organizing in the first place, or who had really gotten inspired. So things started new kind of in January, and then we're talking about, so really 2.5 months, so things happened quick. Right?
The movie Selma was like 2.5 months long. I mean, if you think about it, that's it, right? Between when they arrived in January and, you know, Bloody Sunday on March 7th.
So then in February, the conflict really comes to a head. Probably all know the Selma story, when Jimmie Lee Jackson is killed, and those who want to march from Selma to Montgomery. Right? This is 1965. At this point, you have many who are within SNCC who are like, we don't, what's the purpose of this? Like, do we really need, we understand we want to memorialize Jimmie Lee Jackson. We understand the injustice that was done. We understand the need for drawing attention to his murder. We even like the symbolic power of bringing his casting from his hometown and laying it on the doorsteps of the Capitol, George Wallace's doorstep. But one, this is would be resource draining and dangerous. And would take away from the work that we're trying to do on the ground. So they actually decide in a meeting in early March, they got to decide, all right, we are not going to endorse the Selma to Montgomery march. He's like, we're not going to endorse it. Anybody, in true SNCC fashion, right? But anybody who can't tell you not to participate if you are a member of SNCC. So anybody who would want to participate, you can participate, you just can't do it as an official SNCC member. So that's why John Lewis, who's chairperson of SNCC at the time, although politically and philosophically, he's much more sort of SCLC in orientation, and those who were much more like him in his political orientation in terms of embracing nonviolence philosophically and as a way of life, having done like Diane Nash. You see him in the front line, right? But not as a SNCC representative. The SNCC as a whole has been like, this moving in a different direction, please.
No,
I'm going to
tell you that
water
there for you as well.
Oh, yeah, I wasn't sure. You don't think? But I appreciate that. I appreciate that. I'm glad. I'm going to need that. So you have this conflict, right? And it's real conflict, right? This isn't just personality, right? This is about approaches to change. And like, what is going to be the most effective? We don't have endless resources, we don't have endless amount of money, we don't have endless lives, right? And what makes the most sense? And people were seeing it differently. So, yes?
I have a question. Do you think that based on their differing directions and endpoints that ultimately the SCLC and SNCC and so forth were going to have to disband?
In Selma or just in general? Well, look, I mean, you always, one of the things that gets played up way too much is this idea of conflict within sort of this moment, right? Especially as a connection to sort of this Black Power era, right? That suddenly around Black, so there's like a good SNCC and a bad SNCC. Like good SNCC is when we begin to hear criticisms of SCLC. Like bad SNCC is when they start talking bad about Martin Luther King. Whatever bad means, right? Actually really authoring a critique. There had always been that critique of King, right? I mean, from when they meet in Raleigh in 1960, right? They're offering a critique of King. So there always had been this sort of, conflict becomes such a loaded term, there always had been these strategic differences, right? That brought them, that they were able to work through sometimes, and sometimes they just pushed in different directions. But that's also the history of any social movement. It certainly is a history of the Black freedom struggle, that at various times, various organizations, the people organizations, would see things differently. Sometimes they will come together. Sometimes they will push apart. You got the Niagara movement, certain groups coming together. 5 years later, a couple years later, you got different ones in the NAACP. Some of the same people, other people have moved in a different direction. Right? Lord knows, if you read anything that W.E. Du Bois said about Marcus Garvey around 1910, you'd be like, God damn, right? What happened here? Did you? Okay. So, would they have, what would it, I'm not a big subscriber to inevitable, right? Looking back at history, we see what it is, right? It was conflict, and there's going to be these different approaches to change, and depending upon who's on the ground, you will have, people who can work together. A lot of times people are like, look, we just gotta go our separate ways. And so this is one instance where they did decide, in fact, to go their separate way, because after that march, in March of 1965, the SNCC was like, look, that's enough. We knew something like this was going to happen, 5 on Bloody Sunday. We'll work with you through the actual march from Selma to Montgomery, which will take place 3 weeks later, because if the people are going to go, we got to go, and we are going to put our full resources into that. But then after that, that's it. And we're going to use that march as an organizing opportunity. And that's what we see actually happen. So I'll say something more about that in a second. Yeah.
You talked about February 1965 symbolically, and you used different events, especially Jimmie Lee Jackson's murder, to point out this transition and this change. On a global, on a wider scale, maybe nationally, that's the same month that's the death of Malcolm X. Mm-hmm. And how does that tie into this narrative in Mississippi, or is this how they connected?
Yeah. Actually connects into Alabama because 2 weeks, a week and a half before before Malcolm is assassinated, he's speaking at Brown Chapel A and B down in Selma, right? And he's brought there because he was visiting Tuskegee because students in Tuskegee had brought Malcolm down to speak there, and his SNCC went panic. One of the folks who just passed away, literally just passed away. She talked about how he was involved in human activism at Tuskegee. It was like, look, Malcolm's up there. Let's bring him down. Let's bring him to Selma. So there was a real resonance in for some of what Malcolm was saying, right? But it's important, I think, too, to understand sort of what Malcolm was and what Malcolm wasn't. Right? So Malcolm. Sidebar, Malcolm was an amazing recruiter, right? Especially for the Nation of Islam. That's what he did. Like, he recruited people into the Nation of Islam. That was his great skill and strength. As an orator, right, he could give voice to people's feelings and emotions and perspectives in a way that many folk were certainly unused to hearing, but his skill was in recruiting. And building up this institution that was the Nation of Islam. What he wasn't was an organizer. Right? Not in the same way. In fact, one could make an argument that his great failing was his inability to organize outside of the Nation of Islam once he separates, right? Which exposes him. Right? He's unable to sort of build an infrastructure around him that will protect him. I mean, the OAAU, notwithstanding, right? I mean, it clearly wasn't strong enough to sort of you know, prevent him from being killed. But he wasn't the skilled, trained organizer that you see folk who cut their teeth in Mississippi and Alabama. And so part of his appeal and resonance, especially for young activists, whether they were in Mississippi and Alabama, or even somebody like Adam Lang, or folk who were, you know, living in New York or Detroit, had everything to do, if you weren't in the Nation of Islam, had everything to do with his ability to articulate a critique of racism and capitalism that you just didn't hear publicly, right? And to put it in, and to frame it in a way that just made sense. And so having him come down south was really important, especially in this post sort of separation year, because you're suddenly thinking that, wait a minute, the voice of the North, for example, as an example, is talking about the importance of what was going on in the South after, for a decade, he had been hypercritical of them publicly, saying you can't do, critiques of March on Washington, critique of King after the Birmingham church bombing, right? You critique of the Freedom Ride. Like, what? Like, are you crazy? Like, what kind of strategy? This is Malcolm, right? Not me. He says, what kind of strategy is, you said you're going to protest the federal, what the federal government is doing. Before you do that, you're going to tell the federal government what you're doing and where you're going. Right? Like, that was his critique of the Freedom Ride. You can't give him advance. I said, how revolutionary is that? But that's also Malcolm not being the organizer strategist, right? In terms of knowing what happens and where you go down, that's rhetorical Malcolm. But once you get to late 64, 65, Malcolm is sort of really moving away from sort of that heavy rhetoric and understanding what it was and the incredible work that was actually being going on in the front lines in the South. Right? And so it's really a matter of speculation and possibility of where Malcolm would have moved. It may, had he lived. Some will say that, and I don't think this is right, that what was happening within SNCC in particular was that SNCC activists were moving closer towards Malcolm. I actually think Malcolm was moving closer towards what SNCC activists and others were doing in the South. Right? Because if you were in the Nation of Islam under Elijah Muhammad, he was expressly saying, you can't participate in the political process. You can't vote, no voting, right? I mean, he had his own reasons for that, real step back. So hands off, right? Unless it was a secretary. But that was a bad. I'm just saying. I just speak truth. That's what I'm saying. There's some issues there. Just saying. If you're white, don't repeat that. That was part of Malcolm's critique, right? He was like, part of what was so frustrating, of our frustration and disillusionment for Malcolm, was the hypocrisy that he saw from someone who he literally deified. Right? So once that image is shattered, all the things that he had offered as a critique of a criticism of King and others in the South, suddenly he begins to question. And so his trips down to Tuskegee, his trips down to, willing to go into Selma, was also exploratory for him to say, okay, let me try and make sense of this. And so in a very real way, he's moving closer to what was happening in the South.
Right?
This is the same
time he's internationally also begins to expand his purview.
Yeah, I mean, the idea, this whole notion of sort of what is orthodox Islam, right? As opposed to sort of the teachings of the Nation of Islam, right? And seeing sort of the disjunction, right? It's like, wait a minute, there might be a little bit something more here, right? Like to just call all white folk a devil doesn't really work. It doesn't mean they were good, right? He was just like, I'm not going to deify them and make them something other than human, which is also a different kind of political critique that I think he's offering. But one of the things that they're actually coming together on, that Malcolm and folk in the South, is also this idea of black nationalism. And I want to say more about that in a second. Organizing in the wake of the march. So snake activists are like, look, we're not gonna officially endorse this idea of the March of Selma to Montgomery. We're not really feeling it, but we're gonna go ahead and help resource it, because you go where the people go, you go where the people wanna go. But they also saw it as a valuable organizing opportunity. So this march from Selma to Montgomery, 55 miles, roughly 50 miles of which, almost 50 miles of which go through Lowndes County, Alabama, Highway 80. In other words, you can't go from Selma to Montgomery without going through this stretch of rural Alabama, Lowndes County, Alabama. And Lowndes County, Alabama was notoriously known for being sort of violent white supremacist place. Like, this is a place where you just didn't mess around. You didn't get involved in, quote unquote, that mess, and you didn't mess with white folks. And this wasn't something new either. Like, literally the title of the book is Bloody Lowndes because that's what people called it. For generations. So one of the things that I did in trying to figure out, okay, so when I began to write this, when I began to write the book, I knew what happened in 1965. I knew what happened in 1966. The first question I had to ask was, why 1965? And why not earlier? Why not a year earlier? Why not 2 years earlier? Why not 10 years earlier in 1955? Why not 20 years earlier when these veterans are coming home? Right? Why not 30 years earlier? Then you get the sharecropper strike. What was so critically important about that was not the willingness of African Americans to step forward publicly, but it's the response of white landowners to it. And how swift they are in suppressing it. So once I really keyed in on that, then I started looking at the record of racial violence in a place like Lowndes County, Alabama. And the number of lynchings, which actually are not that far, is a crazy thing, right? Lynchings prior to the 1930s, not that hard to uncover, right? I mean, they're in the newspaper. Up until the 19-teens, they're being advertised in the Montgomery Advertiser. They'll say, this is progressive for the white South in the 1920s. Montgomery Advertiser has some progressive quote unquote leaders. There's going to be a lynching to take place in Lowndes County, Alabama tomorrow, and that's a shame. But they advertised it, right? So people would then show up for this, right? So you have these spectacle murders taking place. You have beatings. I remember reading through the governor's paper, these farmers in Bentonville are writing to writing to the governor saying, listen, could you do something about this landowner, white landowner, because he's using, everyone knows that he's using his farm as the whipping place to be Negroes in Lowndes County, Alabama. So there was a day-to-day sort of violence. And so you got these spectacle lynchings that might occur one every 3 or 4 years, spacing increases over time, public, involving landowners. Nobody's masked, by the way. There are no masked murders in Lowndes County, Alabama, up to and through the changing of power between white hands and black hands. This is 1970. Not a single masked murder. Masked.
Are you saying
masked? I'm sorry, no, I just realized it was a New York thing. Masked. No one's wearing hoods, no one's wearing robes, right? Like, everyone knows who's doing it. Names appear in the paper. There is no secrecy. And that really says something about the air of terror that people were living in. When you knew the people who had done the killing in the county. Like, you knew them. That is what paralyzes people, because you understand the consequence. even if it's 10 or 15 or 20 years old, and people were talking about the people who died in this sharecropper strike 30 years later, when the local movement really begins to pick up, the Niles County Christian Movement for Human Rights, people begin to knock on doors, they're saying, remember what happened when? It's like that 30 years ago, but it felt fresh. And that's what living with white supremacist terror does. That feeling of terror doesn't evaporate. So, SNCC activists are very much in the mind, Kobe Carmichael, a handful of others, Bob Mance, another one goes in there. They're like, look, we're gonna go and try to organize Lowndes County, Alabama. And they literally talk about it, write about it, memo. Sort of domino theory. Right? So if we can crack Lowndes County, Alabama, if we can tip the domino that is Lowndes County, Alabama, all of these other black belt counties will then fall. And by fall, we mean we will hopefully be able to encourage these other counties to organize, to rise up, if you will, by organizing for the vote, for quality schools, to gain access to the farm committees, etc. But if we do it in Lowndes County, because the reputation is so terrible, we will be able to perhaps organize the rest of the black belt. So they purposely chose, one, because of the opportunity, because of the Selma to Montgomery March, but they also purposely chose a place that they knew would be hard as heck to organize.
You know what the demographics were at that time?
80% African American.
So you were saying that it is dominantly in the minds of whites, that black power men were white power men, which was use of force and violence. But now when you talk about the place, I get it. Like in my mind, you set this image of, oh my God, all these black counties, 80% black people, if they all were armed, what the hell would happen, right? So, yeah.
Numbers, I mean, yeah. Strength makes
numerical. So if you get rid of that fear and get them to quote unquote rise up, yeah. That's not a good place to be if you're not one of those.
But that's also not something that is new to 1966, right?
I'm just saying, when you start talking about black power, it adds a whole other element
when you have
to that
numbers.
Reality.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Now, look, white folk knew that if they gave, especially the black folk counties, if you enfranchise African Americans and made the electoral playing field even, they lose. But that's just not Alabama, that's Mississippi as well.
Ultimately they did not want black people voting, but their real fear was of black retaliation for all the years of stuff that had gone on. You're talking about 80% black place. I mean, this city in Jackson, Mississippi, if we had something that go on, we're 80% black. Every black person in Jackson said, you know what, I'm getting a gun tomorrow, and tomorrow we're going to march on the state capitol, which is right up there on Capitol Street. And not only are we going to turn them big guns around sitting out in front of the Capitol, fire them into the Capitol. No, that's a real threat of violence, you know what I'm saying? That can be palpable.
No, it is, it is. And it is, but I think it's framed like that. I think there's a way to frame it, right, that you're saying I think is accurate. And that is, whites have always feared. Right, especially in the Deep South, but even elsewhere, but especially sort of its former slave states, right? That power has always proceeded through violence and force. And that's a way of understanding power and how power has been exercised, right? And so if you're talking about power, right, is there any other way of conceiving the exercise of power other than the way that we have been doing it? And so if we cede power to any other group, i.e. black folk, is there another model for them to follow other than what we have offered? So is black power anything other than black folk doing to us what we did to them? And if that's the case, then Lord have mercy, help us. But the irony is, black folk ain't gonna lie. I don't know if it's Christianity, just a loving people, right? All the shit that black folk have taken, white folk got a long time ago. Like, it ain't gonna happen, right? Even now, you think about all the rebellions and firsts, like, white folk ain't got nothing to worry about, right? Black folk, you're just too nice.
Everywhere in the world. Where you go?
What you say?
Everywhere in the world.
The whole way in the world, right? Mm-hmm. In the world.
South Africa.
It's white folk worried about whites of power were worried about what other people would do, and if they do the same thing in power, what we did to other people. That's why people want to build walls. That's a separate story, right? So one of the things they do once they get involved, once they decide to move on Lyles County, they organize in the wake of the march. And literally, as the march is going through Lyles County, Alabama, for 3.5 days, civic organizers are collecting names and getting addresses, and you know, and then when the march is over, they come back. Small group of five, they literally move back into the county when the march is over to reconnect with those people who they had gotten addresses and contacts with, asking people, hey, is anybody doing anything here? And they knew what to ask, right? They didn't say, hey, do you want to do something? They said, hey, who's doing something? Right? And what are they doing? And what are their names? And who are they? And they are able to connect with a small group of local people who had, just as in many other places, had begun talking about and had attempted action to register to have a voter registration challenge on March 1 before Bloody Sunday. And they connect with those folk, and those folk offer them, critically important, in April, their own Freedom House. Right? Because at that time, these SNCC organizers are trying to connect with people and they're coming in and out of the county. Right? Come in during the early morning, leave in the evening. And one of the movement families, I'm sure you've heard about them, numerous movement families, you got them everywhere, they connected, and in Lyles County was a family called the Jacksons. The Jacksons offered them this Freedom House, said, look, you can stay. His oldest son had moved off to California. Look, you can stay here. You don't have to keep going in and out of the county. And those SNCC activists were just as happy to get that house that had barely had any electricity and certainly had no running water, but had a place to stay. So they could wake up in the morning, get some water out of the well, wash up, wasn't too cold, and then head out and start to work. The Library of Congress has these great, I don't have any images here, the Library of Congress has these great images of Soapy Carmichael, in fact, Look magazine. Remember? That's before my time. I don't remember it, I'm just saying. So Look magazine did a photo expose in March of 1960, in April of 1965, with Soapy Carmichael and state organizers in Lyles County, Alabama. And it's wonderful because it's one of the few times where somebody actually said, well, let's follow organizers. Right? And so it's not a mass demonstration, it's not a mass march, but you see Carmichael and others addressing a small group in a church. You see Carmichael shooting hoops on a makeshift basketball hoop on the back of a barn with some young kids. Right? All this becomes sort of organizing activity. You see him on a mule, right? Like literally cutting through and the paved roads, the unpaved roads, in some of the black communities in Cordesville. Right? So doing that sort of day-to-day work that others have, most certainly John Dittmer talked about, Charles Payne and Emily Crosby talked about, that day-to-day organizing work that you almost never see captured, because it's not glamorous. Right? I mean, it's that drudgery that's captured. But what happens is they become a part of the community, and that becomes so critically important to organizing. Right? They become part of the community, not in a way of, you know, black folk would just take anybody into the community, right? Because you had that dangerous. But in a way that they proved that they were willing, they understood what the threat was, and they were willing to spend the time and energy to see this local struggle through. And one of the things is this incident that happens at the local black high school, right? 10 years after Brown, and the schools are still completely segregated. And they're having a hard time. SNCC activists want to help local folk, local movement, non-Sign Christian movement, have this mass meeting. And they're like, all right, we'll help you kind of organize the mass meeting. So they said, we're going to stop the buses, the school buses, on their way home, right? On the way to school and home. Literally, if you could imagine, SNCC organizers stopping these school buses that are all driven by African-American students, by the way. That's what you do in the rural South, right? You don't actually provide them like real bus drivers. You get a student to drive these buses. So they're flagging down the students, jump on the buses, and say, hey, you know, we're having a mass meeting, bring these flyers home to your parents. you know, a lot of kids are like, yeah, chill, like, that's all right, I don't know about that, right? But then, so then, all my brothers, they actually go to the training school, Lowndes County Training School, one of the two large high schools, the largest black high school there in the county, and they start handing out flyers to the students, right, before they get on their buses. And black principal there, who was never really, from all accounts, was never really about the people, about the students, I mean, he had some real issues going on there. And this isn't just, you know, black person in power or whatever. I mean, he really had, like, could you please stop messing with the 12-year-old and the 14-year-old that black issues, like, personal issues, right? So he has an issue. It was very clear that he's the one that called the county sheriff. It was like, we got some people down here, you need to come check this out, right? So deputies show up, and Carmichael was like, they're like, hey, what are you doing? They're like, we're handing out flyers. He said, you shouldn't be doing that. I was like, I got a right to do this. Like, what are you gonna do? Right? And now that we got the crowd, students are gathering, right? Like, oh, like, we ain't never seen this before. Like, what's this about, right? And then Carmichael was like, well, you stay here. Right? He was like, we didn't plan on going anywhere. This is the sheriff, Carmichael, right? So they keep on handing out flyers. So they have a little, you know, a little head-to-head, and they come back. And they said, well, we think you should go. And he was like, we're not going anywhere. If you want to arrest us, then you need to arrest us. Other than that, you need to get out of our faces, right? And you can imagine, And so these deputy sheriffs, they don't know what to do. Right? They're literally shook. Like, we have never had black folks speak to us in a public way in front of all these, like, what do we do here? And so what do? They leave. That was a critical moment because all of a sudden, all those little kids, they didn't want to take those flyers about their mouth. They're like, oh, I need one of those flyers, right? And they take them home. And then the snake I was talking about, say, after that moment, they would knock on doors and meet people. They were like, were you those civil rights activists, right? Who talked to those cops? And even if they weren't, they were like, yeah, that was us. So all of a sudden, you see that first major mass meeting. You know, you get a couple hundred people there, right? 2 weeks later, a couple hundred people there. Right after that, the Jackson family is like, hey, come on, you need to stay here. And you begin to see that momentum, right, really beginning to build, in part because of that demonstration. One of the local leaders, John Hewlett, said to me in an interview, he was like, look, at that moment, we knew that they understood what the risks were, right? Now, SCLC had made overtures to Lowndes County, Alabama, and the local folk there said, We consciously made a decision not to roll with SCLC because that nonviolent stuff is going to get us killed. Like in a place like Lowndes County, if you talk about where we ain't going to shoot back, that just meant they were going to shoot more, right? So they're like, we knew for our own survival that we had to associate with people who weren't going to tell us to embrace this nonviolent stuff. Again, that default for them, especially in the rural South, where everybody had guns. I didn't know everybody had guns in the South. Like, you see, I was from New York, right? I came down to Morehouse College, and I walked into the Walmart, and they're like, guns? Ammunition? I'm like, what the hell, right? So, I mean, this the idea, and you get in your mind, you don't realize that gun culture isn't just on the white side of the color line. It's not just on the black side. Gun culture is the South, especially the rural South, where everybody had guns. So it wasn't even, so the funny thing, talk about armed resistance, right? We said, oh, armed resistance meant arming black folk. Black folk were already armed. Like, everybody had guns somewhere, right? Now, they may not have been the highest caliber or couldn't necessarily always shoot straight, but not everybody needed to know that, right? I mean, it served its purpose, right? And so they were consciously saying that we could not partner with somebody who we wanted help. We wanted assistance, but we knew we couldn't partner with people who wouldn't tell us to put down our guns. Because that was antithetical to who we are. And we also knew that we couldn't get others to join beyond that sort of immediate, sort of that tight core of any local, any social movement. You're going to have that small cadre of people who are dedicated, who are there day in and day out. But once you get outside that small cadre to that sort of outer ring, where people are not necessarily in there 23 hours a day, but come in once a week or a matchman, that those folks, you definitely weren't gonna get those folks to put down their guns. Now, I'm not talking about sort of macho World War II veterans either, right? I'm talking about older black women, younger black women, right, across the board. This is great, it's one of the photos in the book, and Emily Crosby, this is her favorite photo. This is this older woman sitting in her home, and she has a rifle, right? Like, that is the face of armed resistance in the civil rights movement and black power era. Like, that's it right there, because that's what it looked like. It wasn't sort of the afro with the bandolier. Well, like, actually, like, she should be on the cover of T-shirts and not Angela Davis. Right? That is much more representative of what armed resistance among African Americans looked like than anything. So, real quick, the birth of the, how are we doing on time? I'm on Eastern, I can't think. 3 o'clock. I'll fix up those so we can have a little more discussion. So, birth of Black Panther, Downtown Freedom Organization. One of the things that happens, and I think this goes back to this question of sort of the local interaction with the national, is that Stokely Carmichael and others, especially Stokely Carmichael, like, I mean, Cortland Cox and others, went into Lowndes County, Alabama, beginning of March 1965, spring of 1965, knowing they wanted to create an independent political party. Like, they went in with the idea of creating an independent political party. But they don't go in March, April, May, June, July, and say anything about independent politics. Don't say a word about it to anybody. In part because they felt that if they came in March or April and said, hey, here's an idea, why don't you create your own independent political party and run a county sheriff, run somebody as a county sheriff or probate judge, and the black folks there would have been like, y'all crazy. Like, you do know we can't even vote, right? So what they do strategically as organizers is say, okay, we have to see how we get webbed in so we can be trusted, right, and build up this sense of reciprocity, but we also have to build up a set of political experiences that this becomes, in the eyes of local folk, a viable alternative, a viable way forward, if at all possible. And so you see, over the course of that summer, the local activists actually gaining a set of political experiences in challenging white power and being rejected, offering compromise and being rejected, offering to share power over the 80% of the population and being rejected, that they then say, you know what? After the Voting Rights Act is passed, after Jonathan Daniels, a SNCC, white SNCC volunteer, is murdered, after they are undercut when they try to gain equal access to the Agricultural Stabilization and Conservation Service, the farm committees, like, we were talking about sort of what white fear was, and white's fear, and what black folk in power would do. Black folk were giving white folk every chance to correct the record. Like, hey, how about we share power, right? They're like, no, right? Well, how about we don't desegregate schools, you just give us a few more resources at our black school? No, like every chance, right? So finally, they were like, forget y'all then, right? So when Carmichael says, you know what, there's this old law on the state books going back to Redemption that says you can create your own independent political party, what do y'all think? After 4 months, after a lifetime of dealing with white supremacy, after 4 months of challenging white power and offering compromise, and after a lifetime of the way in which black folks survived was creating independent parallel institutions, i.e. black churches, black Masonic organizations, black schools, they say, let's create independent, your own political party. Black folks are like, well, where do we sign up? Especially the movement organizers. There's one organizer, he said, you know, Carmichael came to us and said, you know, you really can and should create your own independent political party, versus going into the Democratic Party after the Voting Rights Act passed and registering to vote, what are we going to do with our votes? And he said, you know, we thought about it, and we realized that Lyndon Johnson, the Democratic Party was the party of Lyndon Johnson that turned their back on Fannie Lou Hamer. The state party, the state Democratic Party was the party of George Wallace, and a party whose slogan at the time was what? Close enough. It was white supremacy for the right. White supremacy. That's the official motto and slogan of the Democratic Party, the state Democratic Party. And then at the local level, he said Democrats were the ones who had done the killing in the county had beat our heads. Like, what sense did it make then to join that party even if we were going to try and transform it from within? So if there's a way for us to challenge party on our own terms, then let's do that. And so the suggestion is just that, a suggestion. But the experiences that black folk have been having leads them to embrace the suggestion as something that they should seriously consider moving forward. That's why it resonates. It doesn't resonate because Stokely Carmichael, and I'm using Stokely Carmichael to speak for all the state activists who were there. It doesn't resonate because Carmichael was a movement messiah, right? Who descended from on high to Lowndes County, Alabama, had this grand plan, and they were just swept away by his moving and powerful oratory. He came in with a concrete plan, and they had a set of shared experiences and a lifetime of memories that said, you know what, if this has worked in these other areas, in these other avenues of our lives, then why not try it here? It resonates for real reasons. But then they don't stop there. The activists, and this is what really begins to set and drawing on the experiences of what happened in Mississippi, the experiences on the ground of political organizing in Mississippi, Stig Ackerman say, you know, it's not just enough to create a third party, an independent political party, if it just replicates the same kind of politics that the Democratic Party had been about. So the traditional politics, right? Like that's, like what good is that? If it's about exclusion and exclusivity in decision making, or narrowly limiting decision making to a handful of people. The average education for black folk in Lowndes County in 1965, 1966 was the sixth grade. So one of the things that they do is they have these series of political education workshops where they are literally going through the duties of elected officials for all the citizens. Right? And they have, because of the high rate of adult illiteracy, they come up with these cartoon storybooks, Freedom Farmers. So that if you only had a third or fourth grade education, you can make out in reading what the duties in these cartoon storybooks, what the duty of the coroner was, or the sheriff, or the board of education, or the tax assessor, or the tax collector. And at first they hold first of these workshops in Atlanta, but then the demand was so high, by early 1966, they're holding bi-weekly workshops across the county. So people could attend and learn the duties of elected officials. And so they're literally turning on its head to a traditional American political practice. And how do we empower people who have been disenfranchised? Like, it's not enough. When we think about that chronology and disruptions, like, how do we know that folk on the ground didn't view 1965 as the end? Because we look at the actions after. And we ought not view 1965 as an end, or any of this legislation as an end, but as the beginning of another phase in struggle. So now that you have the vote, what are you going to do with it? Like, there are no civil rights activists who say, oh, once black folk have the vote, we're good, all done, up to you, do what you want. Like, no, now you have to give meaning to it. And so places like Lowndes County, Alabama, begins to sprinkle out, reverberate afterward, is what do you do with the vote once you have it in hand? And these political education workshops really go a long way in trying to educate and inform. And we have, when we think about the civil rights movement, we often think about voter registration.
And America, in terms of political practice, has done very good at mobilizing voters through voter registration. But we have not done, we have done a terrible job, and one of the lessons lost from the civil rights era is it wasn't just about voter mobilization, it was also about voter education. Right? Investing in these political education workshops. That was about educating voters. Not to do what I say, but to do what you feel is right. So what we're really seeing on the ground is a new kind of politics emerging in Lowndes County, Alabama. And really, that's an echo of what was happening on the ground elsewhere throughout movement territory.
What were they telling us to do? To not tell them to do what they're
suggesting they do? One, they were like, look, these are the duties of elected officials. First, the focus was on the county government, right? So these are the duties of the sheriff, coroner, tax assessor, tax collector. This is what they can do, this is what they have been doing, this is what's legal, this is what's not legal. Right? And they were, so literally, imagine these political education workshops and people are like, wait a minute, you mean the tax assessor couldn't do that? Right? Pointing out that the reason why these homicides, these lynchings are never prosecuted is because the coroner is the one who decides whether or not it's a murder or not. Right? And they're like, oh, dang, that's the coroner's fault. Right? I mean, so one is about, so literally, these are the duties of elected officials. So now you can decide if that elected official is living up to their obligations. Do you re-elect them? Do you keep them in office, or do you vote them out of office? But then also, more importantly, once you know the duties of elected office, maybe you will want to run yourself. And then that's exactly what you get. So when the Lowndes County Freedom Organization is officially formed in December of 1965, they don't form with candidates already in mind. Like they literally form a party, and they choose as a ballot symbol as Black Panther because of the high rate of adult illiteracy in Alabama. The state of Alabama said that every political entity, every political party has to have a ballot symbol. And the ballot symbol of the Democratic Party was a white rooster, rural people. So part of what they were saying was, as John Hewitt often said, he was like, look, we knew the relationship between roosters and cats. It was like cats chase chickens, and when they catch them, they kill those chickens, and that's what's going to happen on election day. We're going to catch up with that rooster, and that's going to be the end of that rooster, because we're going to be in power. So it was a rural symbolism, but then there was also symbolism about the attitude of a panther. Right? Panthers were indigenous to Southeast Alabama, so these rural folk understood. And they said, look, we understood the nature of cats, the nature of panthers. You see a panther ain't going to mess with you. Right? If you leave it alone, but you back that panther into a corner, that cat's going to come out fighting for life or death, and that's the situation that we find ourselves in Lowndes County, Alabama. And it's that symbolism, the power of that metaphor, is in part why it resonates far beyond Lowndes County, Alabama, why Huey Newton and Bobby Seale would adopt it as the symbol of their organization later that year, and why it becomes really the iconic symbol of the Black Power era, the sensibility of Black folks feeling themselves, whether you're in rural Alabama, rural Mississippi, or Detroit or New York, the sense that you felt backed up into a corner, and that it was a matter of life or death, and it was time to come out fighting for life or death. Malcolm said, it's time to stop singing and start swinging, right? Like this is what they felt, right? Like this is the pressure that they felt. So connected to sort of what they were asking people to do was this idea, if now that you know what the duties of elected official are, you can run for office. Like there was a sense, it's hard to imagine this post the last presidential election, right? But there was a time when people felt that, well, you actually had to be qualified in some way, shape, or form to run for office. And you just can't show up one day, right? But that qualification could also be, was also very much used against Black folk, right? That, well, if you didn't have a college degree, then you don't have what it takes to be tax assessor or to hold elected office. So it automatically that excludes 90% of Black folk in Lowndes County. So what they were saying was, no, let's change how we're defining what it means. If you are qualified, means you know what the duties of the office are.
and you know how to execute them. So you don't, so wealth, whiteness, and previous political experience are not prerequisites for participating in the political process or holding office.
And because the South, also like Mississippi, tried nullification practices such as increasing their requirements, and this gets to our discussion, you do not have any say to you in our discussion. Now you have to be quiet. Was they increased the requirements to run as a third party? So Mississippi, they increased the number of signatures that you had to even get on the ballot. And then they increased the amount of money you had to pay
to get on the ballot.
Right. And so they, and these could be just nationally too for getting on the ballot. They have to win so much of the vote to be automatically added to the ballot or the next time or to be invited to debate. And so that not only worked in the black parties, but with whites who wanted to run as third party or independent candidates as well, so that they could hold on to the two party system the way that they have been, and then making positions appointed. Like you said, for a city clerk, you gotta have a degree, but we're also gonna appoint you rather than you running for office or citywide, multi-mirror districts, and all that stuff, all ways to keep black and brown people and women independents off the ballot. And those things still exist today, and most of you are these sun-filled southern places that all these things continue to exist and continue to work against minorities having political power and exercising power.
And it's a long history. I mean, we see that you just described the transition from Reconstruction to Redemption. Yep. Right? Suddenly, county commissioners, places like Lyons County, are no longer elected, but they're appointed by the governor. Right? So, I mean, there's these endless mechanisms, right, that have to be identified for the as what they are, right? Mechanisms designed to preserve the power of certain people and keep power out of the hands.
But then doesn't it seem, and this is the antithesis of what you're saying, if we know that this is a top-down structure, mm-hmm. then why keep going for
Who's the weak?
If the educated voter, if the voter who knows the system that's in place.
Wait, who's the educated?
I would hope every person who goes to the ballot box is educated enough to know what they want.
Okay, go ahead. Yeah.
Okay, so when I'm going into the ballot box,
yeah.
You know, no offense. I don't care what they do for y'all. I'm looking at what have you done for me lately? And what will you do for me tomorrow? Mm-hmm. So how am I going to be affected by my vote? So if I know that this is a top-down system, if I know that the schools that my children attend are going to be affected by the person that I put in as governor, mm-hmm. if I know that whether potholes in my street are going to get fixed depending upon whether I live in a black neighborhood or a white neighborhood based on who I put in as governor, mm-hmm. then shouldn't I start with my governor vote and then work my way down on the ballot? Because that's the person who's going to be putting in the appointments?
I think it depends, that's assuming that we are all prioritize our interests in the same way. And we don't. So if I voted in my economic interests, I probably wouldn't be voting Democratically. Ohio State basically pretty good. If I voted in my purely economic interests, I probably wouldn't be voting Democratic, at least for governor, right? But I don't, because my narrow economic interests aren't my top priority. And I actually don't even see that as my long-term economic interests aren't sort of tax cuts, like personal individual tax cuts. I think we're more harm than. But what I'm saying is, right, but so the short and the long is we don't equally prioritize, right? So when we're thinking about the contemporary, the most recent presidential election, people are like, well, what happened? Like, how did this happen? Look, I was caught off guard by it as well, right? In part why? I tend not to vote for candidates who are expressly racist or sexist or nativist or anti-working people And I really tend not to vote for them when they're all of that combined. Right? And I thought that others shared that kind of priority. And it turns out that 94% of black women did. 89% of black men did. But most white women who voted did it. So what happened? Like, there's a priority thing there, right? And we're not just talking about sort of working class people or poor people, like, who didn't. If you look at the numbers, political scientists will tell you, right, suburbs of Ohio, right, these people voted in a particular way. So it's really about how people are prioritizing the interest. So I don't think it's just a matter of, like, that people are educated, like, why are they doing this if the system doesn't work for you, right? Well, it depends on how you see the system working. If the preservation of sexism, if the preservation of patriarchy, the preservation of white supremacy, you see that as in your best interest, then guess what? It's working for you. Now, there may be a different critique that says, you know what? You know, building walls is not in your best economic interest, but if you see that as such, then that's what it is. Like, why would poor whites fight for the Confederacy? Like, that shit didn't make no sense. Not from an economic standpoint. Unless you're trying to preserve white supremacy, which means that you're now going to maintain sort of excluded labor of white or black folk, right? So really, it's just a matter of how people prioritize. And I think that we have to take that seriously as well. And one of the things I think comes out of the civil rights struggle is you have to take African Americans seriously as political thinkers. And I'm not just talking about Stokely Carmichael and these activists and people who become highly involved in the thing. I'm talking about folk on the ground, that person with a sixth grade education who says, you know what? Forming an independent political party makes the most sense for me. Like, that is a conscious political decision. They're making a calculation of what's happening in their world and saying that this is my way forward. So looking at their actions, like, we then have to take them seriously as political thinkers. And I think we don't do that enough. And for the same reason, we have to take people who make decisions that we don't necessarily agree with, whether that's 1966 or 2016, seriously as political thinkers, in order to understand what's motivating them to do what they, to make the choices that they make. Yeah?
I'm thinking about what you're saying about, and honestly, this is a cool example, has anybody done analysis of how many formally politically elected positions are now appointed? Like, what the shift has been over time that voting for the governor, you realize he's going to make all these appointments that we need to actually vote for. Has anybody done that to say that, you know, we've lost X percent of positions that we once voted for that are kind of lumped into those party lines today?
Yeah, I'm sure I would defer to mine.
Do you mean nationwide or do you mean statewide?
I'd be interested to see by state, but probably
for Mississippi, you can look at black folks count by Frank Parker. He looks at all the ways in which Mississippi engaged in the nullification campaign to not abide by the 1964, 1965, 1968, right, all the Voting Rights Act. And from gerrymandering to changing the actual electoral system. And how they use the rules, how they have so many special sessions to push these rules through, and the ways that they went about doing it. And I know Phoenix, Arizona has a type of system. Any Sun Belt state has these types of systems. You come from all below the Mason-Dixon, you can look at those states.
I love that. And we have a Republican House, Senate, and Governor. And in the last year, it's been amazing how many political appointees. We have no competition anymore. And it was just
a one-party state.
Wait a minute, where are we going to vote for these folks anymore?
Do you have a one-party state?
No.
Sometimes one-party states do that too, right? Right. To keep their power, there's a one-party. Don't make a lot of appointing positions and they can appoint everybody to it. Right? Mississippi had gotten so bad. But in 2012 or 13, I was really ready to pack my bags and leave here because. It was a year that Chris was running against Thad. Is that his name? Chris McFadden, is that his name? Yeah. And he was a Tea Party guy. He was mad because they had to have a recount, and he ran against Thad Cochran Republican. And Thad Cochran campaigned to black people in Mississippi. He said, please come out to vote for the, you know, the runoff election. And unfortunately, we had to go and vote for him because Morris, who said he was going to go to Washington and argue with everybody and fight reduce spending for education, all these Mississippi needs. And so that was kind of a scary moment. But then when they won that seat, they turned around and said, well, now we have all these seats that are all Republicans. Now we want Jim Hood's job. Jim Hood is the last remain of the Bibi Thompson, statewide Democratic elected person in the state of Mississippi. So they didn't want any Democrats running any office in the state of Mississippi. We have two, Bibi Thompson and Jim Hood.
This is almost like digging from below. You know, all this stuff's going on up here, but we're slowly eroding what we actually are going to vote for.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're exactly right.
Which is why we're all thinking about. Because you made the best point when you said, if you were looking at your bank account, then you wouldn't have voted for Democrats. But you have to not just look at the forest, you got to see some of the trees that are in the forest as well. And we're looking at how you're going to be affected by something as simple as voting for that person and then having them take away your power to vote for other things.
Well, I mean, it's political education, right? And that's different than sort of, sometimes we frame this consciousness raising, and other, but we're talking about just basic political education. What happens if this person pursues these policies? And what can they do and what can't they do? And what can you do as a voter and as a block of voters? That's what snake activists at this point are really trying to do, to get people to engage in this kind of way. Not to tell them, look, come to the polls and vote for this. Like, look, learn this, understand this, and then decide for yourself. And we think we can make the right choice, right? But figure this out.
But there's also the issue, you know, you can educate and you can get recognition of the right now. You can educate and you still don't vote. That to me is the final piece.
Who are you voting for? That's the question again. Who are you voting for? Are you voting for people like us who care about other people? Or are you voting for these dudes who only care about people who are just like people? So I know people complain about people not voting, but as a political scientist, I understand that it's also rational not to vote. And people say it's not, but it is. I mean, you're asking me if I walk into my house one day and one dude standing with a 345 and one dude standing with a 32 and they say, okay, you're gonna get shot today. Two of us are gonna shoot you. Well, I'm getting shot anyways. I'm gonna choose me and y'all to stay here and I'm out the door. I'm not participating in this exercise, right? So the question is, who are you gonna vote for? So even if you are registered, if the candidate is someone who you can't even fathom anybody voting for.
Trump, the fool, Hillary Trump, right? Rachel?
Then, I mean, what are your choices? So sometimes abstention is the rational choice.
But is it a paradox where we don't vote? We don't,
I think it's...
Isn't that the antithesis of what they were saying?
Well, a couple things. Yeah. So, one, I know you weren't saying this, but we don't, there isn't, it's often framed as this, like black people don't vote. America doesn't have like a black people not voting problem. America has a people not voting problem. Like Americans don't vote, period, right? And that's also partly a function of what you were just saying, people not seeing it reflected in their lives. But it's also a function of a culture that says we don't want people to vote. Like literally after one of the two political parties has for years worked on suppressing the vote, right? Actively encouraged, working against policies, voting, for example, that would keep people from participating in the political process. So part of the American political tradition that they, in fact, were working against was voter exclusion, right? Like they literally were trying to expand the electorate when the tradition in American society has been to narrow the electorate and to keep it from expanding. Like that's the American political tradition. It isn't one person, one vote. It's one vote for us. And then hopefully y'all won't vote. Like that's the American political tradition that they were working against. So that was one thought, but then there's somebody else said.
How do you change that? I mean, France had they did have lots of parties and they
okay.
Really quickly.
Right, but there's also a difference between, this ties into the question. Lots of parties versus two parties. Right? We live in a two-party structure, mm-hmm. Right? At the national level, right? It's two parties. What they were doing here was only made possible because there were laws at the local level that allowed people to create independent political parties.
party, right? But at nationally, we're talking about a two-party system. So the idea that, you know, who do you vote for, like, you really, you don't have a, there are two sides of the same coin. If you, in the most recent election, you know, Trump or Hillary Clinton, and I would hear, especially my young, sort of in my classes, in my civil rights class, I'm teaching in the fall, and I'm hearing students, after taking a year off, I'm hearing students are like, oh, they're critiquing Trump, I was ready for that. But the progressive students were equally critiquing Hillary Clinton, right? And they're like, oh, this is terrible, she's just as bad. And I was like, whoa. Like, how did this, like, where are you getting that from, right? You can critique her, and I felt sympathetic because part of their critique was that she wasn't progressive enough. It's like, okay, I'm with you with that. But then their response was, well, then we're not going to vote for a third party candidate, or we're not going to vote at all. Which to me, this goes to sort of the pragmatic political education. And this is tied directly to Black Power. And it was like, wait a minute, at the national level, what does this mean then to vote for somebody that could possibly put Trump in office, right? If those are the two candidates that we're going to siphon off votes. Like, that's a political calculation that has to be made at the national level within the two-party system, two-party structure. Right? So we are bound, unless you change the Constitution or some other mechanism, by the structure that is in place. Nationally, it's a little different than at the state level, which can be a little different than at the local level. And I think no one solution, and the things you do at the local level can't necessarily apply the same things at the national level. But in this instance, what people misunderstand about Black Power, you say, at Black Power, they were saying, like, so Carter was like, look, we're talking about creating independent political parties in no places where Black folk have a majority, and the law allows them to create independent political parties. And in those places where those laws don't exist, create blocks of political power so that we can come into coalition from positions of strength. Like, that's understanding the difference between the local, the state, and the national. But always positioning the interests of Black folk first, but adopting it to the political circumstance that exists. And not saying, and not being absolutist, right? And there's no way that I can do this, right? I talk to those students now, I'm like, you look at Jeff Sessions and tell me that this is the same thing yeah. What the Attorney General would have been under Hillary Clinton.
Well, it depends on where you are.
For all the second, we have a short of time, I want to get going here. Go ahead.
It's okay. Do you want to say something more?
I was just going to say that Mississippi, the progressives and the Democrats are just outnumbered. My people wanted to vote for Trump. So even if everyone wanted to vote, people would vote for her. Still, we're outnumbered.
Yeah, but
on a statewide.
Right. And statewide, I mean, obviously we know the electoral college system, we're not going to go into that. It's a series of statewide elections, but to make a difference. Yeah.
Yes, and so thinking about political education, my class, we do an exercise where you try to figure out whether you're a liberal or a conservative, and then we throw out the platform to get to figure out your candidate line up. And then talk about government and position policy. But I think moving forward, it's also probably useful, especially when you think about black power and black empowerment, this idea of being in a position to fund your dreams. More specifically, now you have to work within the two-party system. You have to be able to put that cake up and fund your candidates, so that they can get elected and represent your interests. I mean, that seems very, fundamental to what we need to think about moving forward. And that is tied to black economic empowerment, right? You know, that's what they do. That's what all the special interest groups do. They fund their candidates, and in turn, their candidates represent their interests. And when we understand that, we just have to do more in terms of financing the candidates that we know will work on our behalf, even if it means sticking to the system, the two-party system that we have.
Inject, especially after the recent Supreme Court ruling that sort of threw open this, the
bag of Citizens United and threw open this bag with the influence of corporate dollars into campaigns. When you think about the Georgia special election and how much money sort of went into that, you know, they say, I mean, that's an anomaly, but what, a couple, what does it take, $2 or $3 million to maintain a congressional seat, pretty much? I mean, you basically kind of have to have that.
I think it's up to, yeah, $4 million.
$4 million, I don't know about you, but I don't think it's not paying me that much.
Yeah, here locally, we have our latest mayoral race goes against that theory where Shukwe Antar Lumumba won the mayoral election, but was not the greatest fundraiser. So it's I don't want to call it a new trend, but it definitely goes against those who raise the most funds gets the vote. So it's just going to be interesting to look at local politics here in Jackson.
Yes, but locally, and when we think about the state, going back historically, you know that there's a there has been an upswing in the number of black elected officials. But when you begin to think about the federal level, where much of what needs to take place, that's when it becomes much more apparent that, yeah, we need to be more involved in financing candidates that are going to represent our end. Identifying candidates and funding candidates that are going to represent our community interests.
Well, so and I don't think there's any one solution to it all, right? It's obviously all overlapping, right? So on one hand, it's identifying candidates who are going to represent the interests, who are going to be committed to the people, which is one of the things that comes out of sort of movement politics, right? Find people who are going to represent the people, right?
Be holding to the people. We can't leave people we don't love the people.
So truly, find the love, right? One, and then I was going to say, but then there's also the financing, but then there's also the structures, right? I mean, you have all the financing in the world. If the districts are drawn in a certain way that will always put black folk in a minority, but not a coalition with people who will vote for them, then good luck, right? I mean, so all of that has to be done in combination.
No, I was just reflecting on what you just said earlier. The idea of, I'm really not sure how to do this, but there is a profound and great need to provide at least some political education across the board about people running for office, especially in the African American community. And he's exactly right. If we would just sort of, all of us who belong to a civic club or fraternity or a sorority or whatever, if we would just sort of raise the basic question, how many of you have made a donation to a political campaign? And you will find people who think that, you know, you can run for an office and $5 will get you there. It's incredible. I don't know where we're going to end with this. I don't know what the answer is, but I'm suggesting that it is a real issue in the African American community across this country, period.
Yeah.
And then a lot of people complain about the decisions of certain people when they get in office, but then the people that generally support them, they try to speak at least to the interest that has been articulated by the person who supported them.
The only thing I was going to add about the money is it's not just who raises the most money, it's also who has the base, who has a wider base.
Right.
So raising smaller amounts for many people can sometimes have as much of an impact as one giant donation. So it's not just the amount of money. I mean, and this is one of the things in the first Barack Obama presidential election, he demonstrated that it's not just bringing in the largest amount of money, but really spreading out your base is why that is possible. It's a little more, you know, not just the amount.
Yeah. All right, a couple quick points. So, Meredith Marshall Tyro
real quick. City organizers, after May of 1966, the Valentine Freedom Organization, they select, they have a nomination convention. They're on the books. They're going to be able to run candidates that fall. And SNCC organizers, SNCC as an organization, looks to what was going on in Lowndes County. So the problem, I can be like, look, this is the path forward. This is the program that makes sense. And so they elect the chairman. And then when the Meredith March occurs, SNCC organizers and Carmichael and Cleve Sellers are looking and say, you know what, we can do it along the Meredith March what we did along the Selma to Montgomery March. And so they see that as an organizing opportunity to spread the word of this new political program, creating independent political parties that will be called Black Power. And so defining Black Power, Carmichael and others are very much, they're clear and they're saying Black Power is what we've been doing in Lowndes County, Alabama. But the press and even moderate civil rights activists say, no, it's not. Like, Black Power is not what you've been doing in Lowndes County, Alabama. If it was, white folks wouldn't be so upset. The logic of the moment. But it resonates because Black folk hear and see and understand that this makes sense. Like, this is what we have been doing all along. Independent organizing, parallel institution building. Right, going back to Reconstruction, this is how we survive. So why not in the electoral arena? Carmichael, Martin Toure referred in reflection to Lowndes County as an idea whose time had come. In other words, although in November 1966, we have to do this in thinking about sort of the civil rights movement, what is a victory, what is a defeat? All seven candidates that run for office actually lose. But in a real way, it was a victory because they got the candidates to run. They created a new political culture, right? So constantly having to reassess what's a victory and what's a defeat. But the new political culture doesn't last forever. And very quickly, it begins to turn. And so the freedom politics that had defined the movement begins to dissipate when the movement energy begins to dissipate and people are no longer able to sustain the energy that they had, right? And so as freedom politics declines, we have to, that's the last slide. As freedom politics declines, that's when we move into an era when people are like, we see the value of political, having political faces in office, but what's the return on the investment? And that's when you really get to the disillusionment, right? And people no longer feeling as empowered as they once thought they would be by electoral politics. I'm walking around playing the bathroom. So I'm gonna run out here.
Mississippi in the narrative. Where is it in the narrative? Well, Carmichael, who was the project director in Greenwood Freedom Summer. The whole idea emerges out of Freedom Summer, the political education piece, parallel institution building. The only difference is NFDP was tied to the Democratic Party, and the element in SNCC that didn't want that left to find a place where they could create an independent movement. But they used the same that parallel institution building in organizing a political party. That's why the infrastructure was in Mississippi. They had the political education piece. They had the parallel political structure. They had gone through precinct caucuses, county conventions, and all that. So, I mean, it's really kind of a piece, the Lowndes County movement and the FTP and people suffer.
And violated it, then. The Freedom Democratic Party really was not connected to the Democratic Party.
No.
In an ideological sense.
Right. Although they stayed for 6 years, really kind of caucus within the, maybe the 68 convention. What are they called? Democrats? The Northern Democrats.
comments?
I have a big loud comment that I may be getting totally wrong here, but if I'm not mistaken, and please someone who knows more correct me, wasn't Byron Rustin critical of Black Power in part because he argued that it wouldn't achieve the economic, it wouldn't achieve economic power, which was so important, and that you know, if you elect a few county representatives and you elect some sheriffs, that's not going to change the national scene. I don't know. I'm trying to remember that. So
I'm not sure why it's a firm position on that. I believe they have not mixed it, in terms of that kind of power. This question was asked by the rest of this position on that kind of power.
I guess I framed it a different way. Talk a lot about political power, but I mean, I think some of the issues that we confront today are tied to economic power. And don't we need to complicate this narrative too, in the sense that even in Lowndes County, there's these critiques and conflicts over what we've got to achieve economically.
They are, and I think it's important to keep in mind that in all of these places there was an ongoing sort of economic critique of what was economic critique of the issues, or critique of the economic issues that black folk were facing and complaining. But in as hard as it was to change sort of the politics, it was even harder to change sort of the economic situation and circumstance. Like, how do you essentially, in order to change in a rural county or anywhere else, you're talking about redistribution of wealth. And like, who had the power and authority to do that? Although there was a critique, I mean, the efforts to bring in warm poverty money, like every chance and opportunity that folk on the ground had, they reached out for and tried to do. But it sounds as crazy as it is, but they had, it was easier, as hard as it was, to sort of get black folk voted, let black folk in office, than it was to change who controlled the mechanisms of wealth. But then at the same time, there is this, one can make, I at least make the argument that I think that black folk overinvested in electoral politics. Not that black folk didn't need to do the things that they did, because certainly they needed full and equitable representation in elected office. But there is a sense, and you see it in Lowndes County as an example, that once black folk elected African Americans and had success in electing African Americans to office, far too many of them then sat back and said, "Now do what we sent you there to do." And then this became a question of sort of the influence. Well, who was influencing them? Like, the reason why freedom politics was really working is because you had that movement energy that put these folk in office, that was helping to get people in office with the political education workshops and everything were going on. But then once these folk were actually elected to office, even the most well-meaning ones, and because not everybody is newsflash, not all elected officials, period, certainly not all black folk, are going to be as well-meaning as you would like them to be. And in the absence of pressure on them from below, they can be pulled in other directions. And you saw that happen in Lowndes County, Alabama. You see it happen elsewhere. But in many instances, I think that black folk assume that once, and had good reason to, right? If you look at all the stuff that whites in elected office were able to do to maintain white supremacy, that if you got black folk in these offices, they will be able to create more change than was able to actually come about. I mean, hell, just elected a black person to the highest office in the land. And the conditions for many black folk got worse rather than better. In part because that's political education. There's limits on how much people understood and know what elected officials can do.
Especially,
but even at the local level, right? So you had, you know, like the sheriff ain't gonna bring in jobs. The sheriff can do what the sheriff can do in stopping terrorism, racial terrorism, and the like, the sheriff is not bringing in jobs into your county and your community. And so there was some disillusionment, right? So you could almost track sort of voter participation, right? So it begins to climb rapidly after people are first enfranchised, peaks in many of these rural counties in the early to mid-1970s, by the late 1970s, early 1980s, when you have, in many places, African Americans assuming the majority of county's offices. But then by the early 1980s, it begins to sort of steadily decline among certain populations. So older African Americans continue to vote in high rates of participation. In part, I would argue, I believe, first the political scientists, but in part because they have this longer memory of what once was and what it took. Right. And but for younger African Americans, it's a look at this and like, man, how have we benefited from this? You think about even the most recent election, and I was trying to figure out the sort of the politics of what is driving these young progressives, these are mostly white kids, but black kids too, who are sitting in my classes saying, I'm not gonna vote for Trump, I'm not gonna vote for Hillary Clinton. There's no difference. And I'm realizing that, you know what? They don't, like, their only political sense at the national level, only political memory, is of Barack Obama. Like, they don't even remember George Bush. Like that things could, like, something worse than Barack Obama, right? And it can be so much worse, right? Like, they do not have a personal political memory of that, right? And when you don't have that, that doesn't explain certainly everything, right? I mean, there's a lot going on with people on the internet. But when you don't have that, that impacts your willingness to participate, or how you see the value of your vote in terms of how it can influence people. But the overinvestment is simply to say that politics wasn't going to change everything. It could do a lot if you needed it. You certainly couldn't do it without it. But there had to be sort of radical economic transformation, including redistribution of wealth in some way, shape, or form, whether through taxes or whatever, and that never occurred. And then it didn't help that when African Americans and black folk got into office, those economic interests that used to support elected officials when they were white suddenly evaporated. Right? So local banks that used to extend loans to the county boards of education when they were all white suddenly stopped extending loans to them when they become black control. And so how that plays out also impacts the ability of elected officials to be effective once in office. So I think the short of the long is, yeah, it's complicated. I think you really needed all of it. But I would add, keep in mind that the folk who were engaged in this work were very much aware of that. We're thinking about it. Like, how can we do it? Like, what makes the most sense moving forward? And they're looking at what works and what didn't work in other places when they're thinking about how to construct a pathway forward in the places where they are. Now, it's not always the same. It doesn't always look different. But it's one of those things that black folk had always been engaged in, whether that was forming farmers' co-ops at the turn of the century or trying to bring in more poverty money in the 1960s, right? Whatever opportunities were available, you saw black folk trying.